Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'd like to warmly welcome to our annual review of NHS Grampian. There are one or two announcements to make initially. Toilets are there to my right. The fire exit is on the left there. Could you switch off, please, your mobile phones or any other devices? They're not going to cause you a problem. And if you could use freely the microphones when you're speaking, that would be very much appreciated. That's not all I'm going to say. I'm going to say a bit more than that, but that's important to get that over. But there is a change this year to the format of our annual review in that we're conducting it ourselves. But you can be assured the process will be no less rigorous in the absence of the Cabinet Secretary or the Minister for Public Health. This year's approach to the review gives us some additional flexibility as to how the meeting is run. And building on feedback from previous years, we have allowed the maximum time to answer your questions because we know that is very important to you. Listening to you and engaging with you in the future planning of health and healthcare in Grampian is central to this afternoon and a key part of our vision statement. Before moving on to the core agenda, I would firstly like to mention the visit earlier today, in fact just half an hour or so ago, by Richard Carey on my right, Chief Executive of NHS Grampian, and I to the Orthotic Department and Ward 17 at Wood End Hospital. In the Orthotic Department, we saw how the paramed system is making the experience of being measured for orthosis a much better one than traditional casting, while at the same time providing a more accurate measurement. And I think we all found it actually a most interesting visit. There was a patient there who was able to speak about it from first-hand experience, and it was very, very enlightening in terms of putting the patient right at the centre of what we're trying to do. We also visited Ward 17, where we saw how the internal decoration of the ward and the use of the butterfly scheme can help patients with dementia. Both Richard and I were very impressed with the dedication of staff in both areas to improve patient experience. And it just underscores, as to so many trips to hospitals in the area, just how excellent our staff are. Over the next couple of hours, we have the opportunity to demonstrate to you that NHS Grampian is a dynamic and high-performing health organisation, fully ready to work with our partners to transform the care we provide to meet the changing and challenging needs of the population. Our self-assessment document not only provides a lot of information and achievements over the last year or so, but also critically looks to the future. It's not possible to do justice to all that's been achieved in a short document, but hopefully through the discussion this afternoon, we can provide you with a fuller picture. This time last year, we had just published our 2020 document, which describes how we believe services in Grampian will be transformed to meet the changing needs of the population within the resources available to us and making full use of emerging technologies. The concept of change by 2020 has subsequently been adopted by the Scottish Government. The Cabinet Secretary for Health and Wellbeing has published a strategic narrative and vision for achieving sustainable quality in the delivery of healthcare services across Scotland by 2020. The Grampian 2020 vision is entirely consistent with this. I would like to start by updating you on some of the actions agreed at last year's annual review meeting with Michael Matheson, Minister for Public Health. All the agreed actions will be covered during the course of the afternoon. We had an extremely positive annual review last year where progress against all aspects of our business was acknowledged. We were asked to keep the Health Directorate informed of progress with implementation of the National Quality Strategy and the Change Fund. This afternoon's agenda is formulated around the six quality outcomes, so you'll be hearing much more about it and how we're embedding the quality agenda in all that we do. The Change Fund was introduced last year and encourages NHS boards to work together with local authority partners and the third sector to make best use of available resources to improve the lives of elderly people. Within Grampian, I believe we have a good history of working in partnership with other agencies, and the Change Fund allows us to build on this. We are all well aware that to make the step changes required to support people to keep healthy and live at home requires a multi-agency approach. The emerging health and social care integration agenda, which was discussed at our board meeting earlier today, takes this even further, and we're determined to work proactively with our partners to achieve the change required. This will require strong leadership, and we are up for this challenge. We were asked to ensure sustainable progress in relation to the healthcare environment inspections and in maintaining robust arrangements for controlling healthcare-associated infection. Our self-assessment provides more detail, but I'm particularly pleased to report the ongoing reduction in infection rates and our compliance with standards such as those for hand washing and cleanliness. We were also asked to ensure progress with breastfeeding targets and reductions in waiting lists for adult registrations with a dentist. Both of these have proven to be a challenge in the past. We are working hard to support vulnerable mothers to breastfeed, as rates amongst these women are usually the lowest. All areas within Grampian are working towards baby-friendly accreditation to increase skills to support women in making appropriate food and fluid choices. Access to dental care remains a priority, and we have made significant progress in recent years. There is currently no adult waiting list for an NHS dentist in Aberdeen City, and likewise no waiting list for children throughout Grampian. Oral health in children continues to improve through the targeted activity of our Child Smile programme. We were also asked to achieve in-year and recurring financial balance. I'm sure that you will appreciate that a time of a growing elderly population, advances in treatment and technology, and in the current financial climate, this is a particular challenge. We believe, ladies and gentlemen, this can be done through continued robust management of our resources, money, workforce, and buildings. As I mentioned previously, our 2020 vision describes the sort of organisation we will have to be to deliver what is required. You'll hear much more about this later, and certainly there'll be plenty of opportunity for questions. But before opening up for initial questions, I'm going to hand over to our Chief Executive, Richard Carey. Richard.
Thank you, Chairman. Welcome, everyone, to our annual review. I'm not planning to say too much by way of an introduction, because hopefully in the course of the afternoon you will get a really strong picture of what we've been doing in Grampian over the past year. But clearly one of the main purposes of an annual review is to do an overview of our performance in the past year. And what I'd like you to do, if you've got the paperwork in front of you, is to have a look at a short summary of our performance under the heading of At a Glance Heat Target Performance, which has been helpfully prepared by Anne Ross, who's in the audience. Thank you for that, Anne. Pointing you in the direction of this helps me just to make one or two points. The first point is that HEAT actually stands for, it's an acronym, and we love acronyms in the health service. HEAT actually stands for targets that are associated with health improvement, efficiency, access to treatment, and treatment itself. So these HEAT targets are all across the breadth of our activities in NHS Grampian, so that, for example, alcohol brief interventions will be a health improvement target, and financial targets met would be an efficiency target. So these suite of targets, if you like, are one of the main mechanisms through which NHS performance is measured by the government. Of course, the government has set the NHS in Scotland many targets to deliver. And I think if you look at that at your leisure, you'll see that we have delivered or exceeded most of those targets, and we're well on course when we've still got a wee bit to go with one or two. But I don't want to just talk about targets, because targets is only one element of what we do in the NHS. And the NHS is, and in Grampian is a very big organisation. We employ 11,500 full-time equivalent staff, but in reality we've got in excess of 15,000 people working for us. We are responsible for in excess of £900 million of taxpayers' money, and we are accountable not only to the government, but we're accountable to you as taxpayers and users of the service for what we do on your behalf. And that's one of the reasons why we put such importance in the annual review process. One of the things that's also important about organisational performance is it's not just about what we do as an organisation. We can deliver targets, but if we leave a trail of carnage and destruction in our wake in the pursuit of these targets, then that wouldn't count by any measure as being a success. So we need to have a culture that is underpinned by our values, and our values in Grampian are very much about caring. We need to provide effective care, we need to provide timely care, but it needs to be caring, it needs to be person-centred, to use the jargon, and that means treating every individual patient as an individual and being as responsive as we can be to their particular needs and circumstances. We also need to be a listening organisation, and again, the values that underpin listening are about respect for others and respect for other people's views, and a willingness to accept the fact that as part of the process of developing as an organisation, we need to take the feedback that we get from colleagues around this room and elsewhere and act upon it and be seen to act upon it. Otherwise, people that give up their personal time to attend patient forums and give of their time voluntarily, they won't come back to an organisation that doesn't listen to what they are saying to them as patients and users of the service. So we put tremendous store in our capacity to listen, and through listening improve what we do. The third strand, of course, of our values is about improving. And of course, in any major healthcare organisation, problems do emerge from time to time. And it's not the fact that these problems emerge, because human beings as they are will make mistakes, things will go wrong inevitably in any walk of life. But the mark of an organisation, in my view, and in the mark of NHS Grampian, is how we respond. And I think it's important that when we are talking at a senior executive level about when things go wrong, if things go wrong, we put our hand up, we apologise, we deal with the situation, and above all, we look at how we can improve as an organisation and make progress going forward. So, not just about targets, but nevertheless, I think we're very good at meeting targets, and I'm very pleased about that. One or two highlights in the year that I want to highlight to you as well. We've recently been given the go-ahead by the Cabinet Secretary for the implementation of our maternity services review, and this gives me an opportunity to acknowledge you know, the huge amount of effort that a number of staff, volunteers and others have put into the whole process of engagement around maternity services review, including colleagues from the government, one of whom is with us here this afternoon. The fact that we have had the endorsement of the Cabinet Secretary for our maternity services going forward is really important, because it enables us to shape and redesign the way that we deliver maternity services that will address our key strategic themes around improving access, around improving services for people who have socially disadvantaged, and indeed for ensuring that we can deliver the highest quality of care for everyone using the service. We also have some exciting stories to tell around the emerging building in the ARI campus. I'm sure some of you will have seen this. Again, this was 5 years ago. This was something that we talked about in meetings. It's the brainchild of Graham, among others, our Director of Modernisation, and Rolf, our director, Medical Director. It's tremendously satisfying to be having discussions now about the building going to be opening in early December, which will replace half of the existing Aberdeen Royal Infirmary with state-of-the-art facilities. The medical staff in Aberdeen Royal Infirmary said to me a number of years ago, when I asked them what was the most important patient safety issue that you felt as senior consultants in Aberdeen was at this precise moment, they said to me that we didn't have a dedicated, high-quality, high medical dependency unit. And we now we're going to have in one of the floors in the new building, opening in December, something which will genuinely be world-class and something for the whole of the North East and beyond to be genuinely proud of. And I just have to say that that project and the work, and I hope you get the opportunity to see it, hopefully not as a patient, but hopefully have an opportunity to see that facility, you will get a flavour about, you know, what a massive improvement that is going to be for the people of the North East. The biggest single healthcare development that has happened in this area for 30 years. So, last thing that I want to do is just to echo the comments and the points that the chairman made about integration of services and about the importance of partnership working across NHS Grampian and, of course, with our wider public sector partners. But I want particularly to make mention this afternoon of the important role that our employees leaders play in all of this, because one of the things that I'm particularly proud of in NHS Grampian is the quality of our employee relations. And we have around the room in each of the tables, we've got staff representatives who work with us as part of the team and do not work in a model which we would describe as old-fashioned industrial relations. We don't do beer and sandwiches and we don't do collective bargaining. We sit down together as part of the same team and part of the same service, and we work through the issues and the challenges that we face together. And I think the contribution of our staff side to the work of NHS Grampian has been immense and is continuing to be of importance to the organisation going forward. I'm sure I'll have missed a few things that I should have said, but just in general, I would like to repeat one thing that I'm happy to repeat. I am incredibly proud to be the Chief Executive of NHS Grampian. I'm incredibly proud of the work that NHS Grampian staff do on a day-to-day basis, and I genuinely believe that the people of the North East get a fantastic service from their health service. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Richard. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, as I said before, we're sort of breaking this up into six themes, and the board trying to give some illustration of this. I think the quality strategy of NHS Scotland has a vision that Scotland would be a world leader in healthcare quality, described through the three quality ambitions of effective, person-centred, and safe. Oh, and I was telling people to switch their mics on. Sorry, apologies about that. Right. The first of the quality, everyone gets the best start in life and is able to live a longer, healthier life. Now, the first written question on this is from Mr. Alexander Mess from Froghall Community Council. Is Alexander, would you like to take your question, sir?
Chair, thank you very much indeed for allowing me to speak here today. I'm the chair of Froghall Community Council. My question was, which I think you've already answered, is the dentist practices now in Aberdeen, is there plenty spaces for the National Health patients? Because clearly a few years ago, there was lots of practices going private and it left a deficit, people not being able to get a dentist. So now that you've told us that, I would like to explore your statement about the child happy face or smile program. Clearly I don't know enough about this, and I do feel that there is still a need, because there's lots of deprivation in Aberdeen. This is a facade. It's an oil city and all the rest of it, but there's a lot of deprivation in Aberdeen, which I and Reverend Andy Cowie sees on a daily basis. So I just wondered, can you enlarge on your SMILE program, what you're actually doing for the children, and so that I can be better educated and pass it on to the people, and what opportunities I can pass on to the people in our area. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Well, in order to do that best, I'm going to ask both Lewis Richard, the Director of Public Health, and Richard Carey to set the scene and then come back to your question, if that's helpful.
I'd like to go to the poster, the first poster. There are six, and as the chairman indicates, this is about getting children in Grampian the best start in life. and encouraging the delivery of healthy and longer lives in Grampian. And each of the six posters, basically, we start off with patient quotes. What patients told us about their positive experience, what they said we could do better, and what you tell us, what patients tell us, is very important to us. And each of the themes start off with this heading. And we would encourage you to come along and look at the detail of the posters after the meeting, and we'll be here for questions. As Director of Public Health, one of the things that I need to be aware of is how healthy we are and how sick we are. This second panel describes at a glance where we stand with most of the health indicators in Scotland. So you won't see the detail from where you're sitting clearly, but in Grampian we have a statistically higher chance of living longer for males and females. We die less prematurely from heart disease, from cancer, and from stroke. But we, if you look further down the list, we're behind certain indicators. In particular, I can just pick out two. We have a higher hospitalization rate for asthma in Grampian, and we've also got a higher rate of road traffic accidents. Now, going forward, one of my jobs and my team's jobs will be to get better quality data about the health of our population so that we can determine how best to spend our resources and how best to measure how we are doing in relation to our population health. And the third panel describes a little of what we're currently doing. Just one or two initiatives there. If this data is about where we are right now, one of the most important things for the board, as intimated by the chairman, is a vision for the future, where we want to get to in 2020. Now, we know, for example, that people living in poorer areas have an earlier chance of dying, and they live longer with poorer health than those in more affluent areas. So one of the big challenges going forward in Grampian will be to mobilize all of our resources, the health board working in partnership with voluntary organizations and local authorities going forward to diminish the gap between those who have and those who have not in relation to health. That's going to be a big challenge. But we're getting there, we're setting out in that road, and we're determined. And so we have a number of aims in relation to this so that we can step our way down this road knowing where we're going to. For example, we need to know more about our population, as I've just said. We need to work with communities who know about the needs of the communities. We need to work more effectively with that. That's not just about the people and the inhabitants of these communities, but the health professionals and other professionals, caring professionals, who work in them. Our health service itself needs to be health promoting. Every time we meet a patient, I as a general practitioner, a clinical GP, others working, wherever they're working in the health service, has the opportunity not only to treat patients for ill health, but to promote well-being. And we need, again, to do more of that going forward. Work is underway. I'm encouraged by what I've seen, but we need to do more as we venture towards 2020. One or two other things here. Time is against us, so I won't tarry. But basically what I will say is that we need to make sure that our resource allocation is in keeping with the needs of our population, so we need to marry them both together. Okay, next steps. We have many, but if we want to pick one or two, let's look at mental well-being. Mental well-being and health well-being, physical health well-being, are two sides of the same coin. If we improve mental health, we improve physical health and vice versa. So we want to step out here and do more about changing lifestyle behaviors to promote better health. Two examples, mental health in early years. The chairman's already mentioned in his opening remarks the importance of breastfeeding. And we have a program here where we're involving volunteer supports to young, newly delivered mothers who are very vulnerable. And this program aims to help get these young mothers at a very vulnerable stage support with breastfeeding using volunteers. switching to mental health in later life. We know when individuals are bereaved suddenly, find themselves socially isolated, that they then lose health. In fact, they're far more vulnerable to premature death when they live alone. So loneliness is one of the major issues in the elderly. And what this second example describes is a signposting project which is connecting individuals with volunteers to add well-being by meeting people, by trying to get them access to things that suddenly they found they were cut off from because of bereavement. So early days, but again, we're encouraged that this is a way of the health service working with volunteers to improve mental well-being in early years and in later life. Richard.
I'm conscious of the fact that we had a question from Mr. Ness from Troco Community Council about NHS dentistry that we do need to handle. I'll read from this because there's a wee bit of detail associated with this, which I think is quite important. In Aberdeen City, there have been two new and extended practices opened in the last 2 months, which offered an extra 20,000 NHS places for patients. And to date, 2,000 to 5,000 places have been used. There are now at least 6 practices offering immediate dental care services within 2 to 4 weeks in Aberdeen City. So what I'm actually trying to highlight here that is on the back of the investment in the dental school and on the back of the investment in the incentivisation around NHS dentistry, we are now in a situation where we have got close to sufficient numbers of dentists in Aberdeen City, although there still may be issues of location and access for particular groups, such as the homeless, which we still obviously wish to address. But in an Aberdeen City context, you know, we've made tremendous strides, and obviously it was alluded to earlier by the chairman that there's now no waiting list for children for access to dentistry, NHS dentistry. There are still a number of issues in Aberdeenshire and Moray, but the situation generally is improving on the back of significant investment. I think if we look as to where we are now compared to where we were 2 or 3 years ago, I think any objective person would say that we have genuinely made great strides, but there is still obviously more to do. One of the really important issues in relation to dentistry, of course, is prevention. And the Child Smile programme, which is about getting out to schools and encouraging good oral hygiene habits at an early stage, again, is showing very positive signs. We have a higher proportion of young children than ever before who are, as they call it, caries free. In that sense, again, there is genuine evidence of significant improvement in the dental health or the oral health of children. The disadvantaged communities and the need to ensure that facilities are available for disadvantaged communities is something that we are very focused on, and we need to work closely on that issue and have been doing. The other couple of things that I wanted to highlight in terms of ensuring everyone gets the best start in life and is able to live a longer, healthier life, I'm going to talk about alcohol. I've actually become a bit of an expert in alcohol because I'm involved at a national level in the what was called the Alcohol Brief Interventions Delivery Group. Now, essentially, an ABI is called an Alcohol Brief Intervention, and what an Alcohol Brief Intervention is aimed at doing is targeting people who are not alcohol addicted, but who may be drinking more alcohol than is good for them. And there is a strong evidence base that with appropriate professional intervention and one-to-one interaction with people that we identify in that category, that we can make significant changes in people's alcohol consumption habits. And of course, reduced alcohol consumption will lead to better health and well-being and all the benefits of that. We have a target associated with this that's been set by the government, which Grampian has exceeded. And I think one of the really interesting things about the alcohol brief intervention target is that we're picking up people in a variety of healthcare settings. For example, genitourinary medicine, if people are involved in
risky behaviour. That can often be associated with alcohol. So if people turn up at these kind of clinics, for example, there is an opportunity there for alcohol brief interventions. Brief interventions can be done in primary care, they can be done in accident emergency, they can be done in the maternity environment. So these efforts to engage and to educate essentially people about the importance of watching their alcohol consumption is a huge priority for us. Another thing that is a priority around health and well-being is a program that I would highlight called Give Kids a Chance. And it's very much about empowering local communities and empowering voluntary organisations to work with us to improve the self-esteem and well-being of young people. And the Give Kids a Chance programme, which you can see a bit more about here, encourages people to work towards achievement of goals that will enhance their sense of well-being. It might be to play a piece of music, to swim two lengths of the pool, to do something active and positive, and give them encouragement and support. And that generation of well-being and self-esteem among young people, I think, is hugely important. And it's something that we're working closely with a lot of input from volunteers in the voluntary sector. So that's just an overview of some of the issues that we're dealing with. Obviously, in such a short space of time, it's not possible to cover all areas and all health issues. But I think Lewis and I just wanted to highlight a few issues that are more associated with best start in life and living a healthier life, and well-being is a key objective of the system. So that's probably enough. Thank you.
Drone Community Council. Is Mr. Patterson here? Yes. Oh, Mr. Patterson, would you like to ask your question, please? Thank you.
Yes, thank you for again giving me the opportunity to make this put this question forward to the review. Considering the significant evidence of the deleterious effects of motor traffic on health, should this issue be tackled by NHS Grampian to a similar degree as smoking, alcohol and obesity? We, the residents of Tillydrone community, are concerned about plans to construct a major highway through our neighbourhood. This will most certainly affect our health and well-being and compound our lower than average health status, as indicated by the NHS traffic lights document recently issued. This is more than a Tillydrone issue and should be a concern to all city residents, considering that only two traffic light indicators for Aberdeen City fall below the Scottish average are traffic related, i.e. traffic accidents and asthma, which was already illustrated, and that Aberdeen City is failing to deal with air quality in several locations in breach of European regulations. Tillydrone residents believe that this is an issue which the population are not fully advised on, has lacked consideration by planners and decision makers, and remains unaddressed by NHS Grampian, whose role should be to bring the health effects of transport into wider consideration. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you. Lewis, could you
respond to this question? Thanks very much. For a start, can I say I welcome this question, because indeed it does raise the issue of the environment on health at Grampian, the effects of the environment. And we do need to look in the round at how important our environment is to us. There is clearly evidence that traffic and atmospheric pollutants increase the risk to health, making respiratory illnesses and cardiovascular illnesses, aggravating them, and we are aware that is the case. However, what we need to do is more about working with our fellow organisations, including Aberdeen City, to identify how best we can work together to try and improve air quality in the round. As I indicated earlier, one of the areas that I'm concerned about is the increased admission rate for asthma across Grampian. And one of the things I'll be doing as Director of Public Health is looking to see what the root causes of that might be, because it is not just an Aberdeen City issue going forward. The particular development which was referred to in the scheme was carried forward by Aberdeen City Council, and they actually carried out a transport assessment guidance on it. And what it did was to look at the impact of this new scheme. And the overall conclusion is that the proposed scheme will result in a neutral impact upon local air quality based upon the balance of beneficial and adverse impacts. Now, what actually happens when you do put a new road in place is that some areas round about it will benefit because you reduce traffic flow on other routes nearby and increase traffic flow on the road, the new road in question. So in that situation, there are improvements and losses within the same area. What I'm aware of, basically, that we work together with Aberdeen City already, and we lead the Health Transport Action Plan Steering Group, which includes representation from Aberdeen City Council and NHS Trans. What is equally important to me is how, in any given area, other risk factors contribute to ill health and hospitalisation. And we know that in Tullydrone, there is an increased risk of asthma through smoking. Tullydrone is one of the highest prevalences in Aberdeen. And one of the things I've asked for, clearly, is the opportunity to see what we are doing in the way of health related interventions in Tullydrone, and I have this list, which I will share with you afterwards, but also I have indicated that we would be very much welcome the opportunity to meet with your group to discuss your concerns so that we can move forward together in this matter.
Is that helpful, Mr. Patterson?
Yes, that's very helpful.
Thank you.
One of the directions that we were looking for NHS to do is to take the same type of campaign as which you would do with alcohol, which Richard Carey was saying is a lack of awareness in alcohol, because we went through there was an inquiry into this. The inquiry was through the compulsive purchase orders. It wasn't a true planning inquiry, which was pushed to the side. And from our arguments against it, we come across an awful lot of information of the ill effects of the traffic pollution on neighbourhoods. And there was so much that we were surprised. And they feel as if people are not educated in these type of things. So when we mention to people simple things like, if you say, do you know that pollution is increasing in areas, even though the cars are staying the same? And it's due to people buying more diesel cars, when in the past people had would buy a petrol car where the emissions are under better control. But now, one in two people buy a diesel car, and the pollutants are in excess of what they were 5 years, 10 years ago. In fact, they find it is about 40% increase.
I think that we have to stick to issues that Grampian Health yeah. will have an influence on.
But oh, sorry.
You were asking about that campaign. I mean, yeah. Lewis, do you want to respond?
Well,
to
again, I think the going forward, I've accepted basically that we need to look again at how our environment impacts on our health in Grampian. And the best way to do that is with our partners, because as the chairman suggests, we don't have all the levers. But what you've heard today already across a number of areas is that we cannot achieve better health in Grampian alone as a board. Mm. We need to do that in partnership with both the local authority, other voluntary organisations, and indeed the communities that we try to support and provide care and well-being to. It's a dialogue that will be very much featuring in our operations as a health board going forward in the next few years.
Absolutely. Well, thank you very much. Mr. Patterson, thank you. Now, the next theme, if I could move on to that, is healthcare is safe for every person, every time. Now, it's vital that the services we provide to patients are safe and effective, and there's a great deal of work that's been done in recent years to take this forward and to indicate that we have robust systems in place to identify where their improvement is needed. Rolf Diekhuizen, our medical director, and Eleanor Smith, our NUF director, will tell you how we're going to take this forward. Rolf and Eleanor, thank you.
Thank you very much. There is, of course, a great concern about hospital-acquired infections, and we have seen several questions that are actually related to that, as to why is it that hospitals have these infections? Is it because, the cleaning standards are not up to scratch, or because of other reasons? Well, there's a very natural cause as to why hospitals are the cauldron of infection, and that is because we take all our ill people there. So all people with infections, they are actually located and concentrated in hospital. So quite naturally, there will be an opportunity for microorganisms to actually come together, have a bit of a meeting and decide how they're going to spread themselves. So there is a particular difficulty with hospitals in terms of hospital-acquired infections, that actually all infections come to hospital. The other thing about hospitals is that hospitals are very busy in terms of traffic. People come in and out of hospital, visitors come in and out of hospital, and not all visitors are knowingly or unknowingly, but not all visitors are well. Some visitors are carrying bugs, particularly with the winter vomiting bugs, which we have, for example, in nurseries, when parents of children come into hospital. You feel well one moment and you're ill the next, so sometimes people don't know that they are carrying an illness that actually could then transmit from the visitor to the patients within the hospital. And if you think about the campaigns that we have been setting up, for example, the hand washing campaigns, this was mainly to actually make sure that people minimize the risk of transmitting an infection. You can scrub the floor as many times as you want, but if the door handles are not clean, and people don't wash their hands, the infection will easily go from one person to the other. And that is actually the reason for the hand washing campaign. So we have worked really intensely with staff and visitors to our hospitals to actually get our hospital acquired infection rates down. Now, I'm a doctor who's mainly worked over the last 20 to 25 years with people of an elderly population. And I always knew 10, 15 years ago that some elderly people, particularly when you prescribe them antibiotics in hospital, would actually develop diarrhea and would develop Clostridium difficile. And I always thought, that's one of those things. That's what happens to people when they're older. They're very vulnerable to this and so on. I actually never realized to what degree we can actually prevent this. The number of Clostridium difficile infections in NHS Grampian, but not just in NHS Grampian, also in other health board areas in Scotland, has gone down with 85%. So from every 10 people, let's say from every 100 people that would develop Clostridium difficile diarrhea in hospital, there's now only 15 developing Clostridium difficile diarrhea in hospital. That's an absolutely amazing result. And I never thought that was possible. It's a combination of this hand washing. It is a combination also very much of prescribing the right antibiotic at the right time and not to overdo it with antibiotics, particularly in elderly people, because our clinicians have changed their prescribing habits quite dramatically, both in the hospital sector but also in primary care. So we have got some good results. There are other hospital-acquired infections, for example, Staphylococcus bacteremia, which is an infection. Staphylococcus is a bug that you carry on your skin. We've all got trillions of them. We've got them on our skin. We've got them in our noses. But actually, if you break the barrier between the bloodstream and the skin for one reason or another, for example, but for putting in a little cannula to give medication through, you have a risk that you penetrate the skin and actually go into the bloodstream and push the bug, if you like, with the needle into the bloodstream, and then people can develop this particular bacteremia. It behaves very differently from the diarrhea we were just talking about, the Clostridium difficile. And it requires different types of methods to actually reduce the infection rate. And there we are taking particular care with the bundles that we put in place when we cannulate people or when we put in a urinary catheter, which is another risk to do it. We've got particular protocols now that we use to actually put this instrumentation into people. And actually, that also is now showing some real results. And I'm really hopeful that what I thought about Clostridium difficile in the past, that it's just one of the things you can, to be kind of shown that that's not the case, I hope actually that it's the same for Staphylococcus bacteremias, that we will see in the next few years a further quite dramatic drop in Staphylococcus bacteremias. So we're very proud of what we've done so far, but we really would like to continue on that vein. Eleanor wants to talk a bit more about some other aspects that we are doing relating to safe patient care. But of course, we also would like to hear some questions from yourselves.
Thank you, Rolf. Rolf's covered some of the things around healthcare-associated infection. But I just wanted to highlight that for NHS Grampian Board, we've actually got a patient safety dashboard that gets talked about in board meetings and senior management meetings. So as well as looking at infection, we look at mortality rates to check that the level of deaths that we see in our system are the ones that we would expect to see. And that's as part of the Scottish Patient Safety Programme. And it would be fair to say that we're making good progress in that respect. And we also look at adverse incidents and report these on a regular basis. We look at falls and we look at patient experience and patient satisfaction. So all of these are things that the board keeps an eye on, as well as the infection information. And while these safety issues are things that we look at a board level, we've also, from a safety perspective, been introducing things from a patient level. So, for example, medication safety is really important to us. And you'll see from the slides here that we've developed materials for individual patients about questions to ask about your medication, about the list of medications you're on, and so forth. So these are really important at a board and at an individual patient level. And we were really proud in NHS Grampian that we were nominated for a leadership award for a national patient safety work. And although we didn't win that and we were runners up in that, we were really pleased that we got to that stage. And I'll just maybe pass back to Rolf.
A little bit more on, if we think of 2020 and the future as to where we want to be, I think there is, in terms of safe and effective care, we can make enormous progress in prescribing and safe prescribing. As we are at the moment, because of the way that drugs are prescribed in hospital, it is possible for errors to occur, because it's still done on paper. That's not just in Grampian, it's all across Scotland, bar one board that has introduced electronic prescribing. So there are errors in prescription are possible. In particular, prescriptions are vulnerable when actually the patient goes from the hospital to back to the general practice, or indeed goes from the general practice to the hospital. Quite often when I admitted patients, say, have you got your pills with you? Because if I had the bag with pills, then I was most sure to know that I knew exactly what people were on. Well, with modern technology, already in primary care, prescribing with the general practitioners is completely electronic. And we hope in the next few years to get electronic prescribing in hospital going also. And in particular, we would hope that electronic prescribing will then be visible at the general practitioner end, as well as the hospital end, as well as the community pharmacists end at the same time. Because that's the brilliant advantage of an electronic system, that different people, wherever they are, independent of where they are, they can actually look into the record directly, simultaneously if need be. So electronic prescribing is something that we really hope to achieve in the next few years, building up to 2020. Also, when we have emergency care episodes, we would actually the first responder, wherever that first responder is, whether that's on the pavement in Union Street or whether that's in the minor injury unit in Turriff, would actually be able, through electronic prescribing, to pull up the patient record for prescribing at a tick of a button. And with mobile devices, like you all know, with iPads and iPhones and so on, and an electronic prescribing system, this will be eminently possible in the future, and we sure hope to achieve it. I have touched on that, yes.
The next question is from Jean McKenzie. Is Jean here? No. Okay. Jean asked a few questions. What is the evidence that hands on visitors to hospitals increase risk for patients acquiring harmful infections? Is there evidence why this handgel not advertised at every opportunity? And a third strand is, who is responsible for replenishing handgel when they have been?
It's very embarrassing, of course, when you advocate hand washing and gelling of hands and then the container is empty. And that is something that, particularly when hand washing and gelling was introduced early on, that actually happened to us quite a few times, isn't it? It's not so easy, actually, to have the logistics of keeping all the containers full. It's also very important to know where to place the containers, because you could theoretically put them in the on the parking places outside the hospital, but that's not particularly effective. So you would like to have them in places before and after the patient-environment contact. So we're really talking about clinical areas. It's important for people to wash their hands before and after they come in touch with the patient. And that is for two reasons. One, before, is that whatever you carry yourself, so if you carry a cold, or if you have diarrhea or something, you should, hopefully if you know it, you shouldn't come to hospital at all to visit. But if you do, that you wash your hands so that you don't transmit whatever you have yourself to a vulnerable patient who may be on chemotherapy or whatever and have no defense whatsoever. So before is very important from that point of view. After is very important because after you've seen the patient, that whatever the patient is in hospital for, which quite often is because of infectious diseases, that you may have picked that up and that you then don't carry it out or don't spread it over, as I said, the door handles and so on through the environment. So after you've been to the patient to actually wash your hands. The evidence is vast. We can demonstrate bugs on hands. It's a fantastic experience if you go through it, because hand washing technique is something in itself. But if you don't wash your hands properly and you put them under the ultraviolet light of this demonstrator machine, you will see patches of bugs all over your hands. And if you wash them properly, you actually see the hands are clean. But there's lots and lots of evidence that actually hands are the most important transmitter of infection that we know of.
And a third question is from Judy Martin. Is Judy here? No, she's not here. Okay. Judy's question is, while prevention of healthcare-associated infections must indeed be a priority for NHS Grampian, are some clinicians' obsession with infection control targets and false targets and the reluctance to record these on occasion for fear of failing to meet targets, jeopardising staff, patients, and visitor safety and well-being?
Yeah.
Eleanor, would you like to take that, please?
Sure, yeah. Within NHS Grampian, like other health boards, we've got a system called DATIX, and that's our system for electronically recording incidents. And we actually really strongly encourage staff to use DATIX for reporting all incidents. So we would be really worried if staff weren't using DATIX, because then it would mean that we couldn't actually learn from incidents and whatnot. What's really encouraging is that the number of incidents that are reported on DATIX on a monthly basis, they're increasing all the time. And that's good, because that's partly because we're continuing to spread the word that we need to use Datex, but it's partly because Datex is rolling out to new places, such as general practice. So we'll expect to see incidents on Datex increasing for the foreseeable future. When we do look at the incidents in Datex, it's important to look at all of them, so in their totality. So when we do look at that, although the incidents are increasing overall, the ratio of harm to no harm incidents is staying much the same. So for every 100 incidents on Datex, maybe 20 of them are harm incidents and the other 80 are no harm or near miss ones. Now it's really important to get these near miss ones so that we can learn. And this is what we see with what's happening locally. So it's a reassurance to us that we've actually got a good culture, which is what Richard referred to earlier on, that we really want to encourage a culture among our staff and among everyone that it's safe to report incidents, that we'll use them to learn from, and that we won't use it in any kind of punitive way.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, I think at that junction we can move on to the third theme, which everyone has a positive experience of healthcare. Thank you, Eleanor and Rolf, for that. Now, requiring to use a health service is inevitably a stressful situation for anyone, but we have a duty to ensure that we make the hospital stay or contact with our services as positive an experience as possible. We also don't want people waiting unnecessarily.